guys. I'm married with one wife, praise God. I've got two kids. My son is 14 years old, and my daughter is going to be 13 towards the end of this year. And we've been married for 17 years this year. Next year, it's going to be 18 years. And what's amazing is that about 17 years ago, I came to Standerton for the first time. I came here with Omyandevet's son, Pietri. It was the first time I've been in Standerton. And then yesterday, Annika's sister pulled out one of my old CDs, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, what was I thinking? You know, I was like, this is not good. You know, so, but it's so good to be back, and it's amazing to see what the Lord can do in one's life if we avail ourselves for Him. Amen. I'm here to tell you this morning that your best days are still ahead of you. Amen. Come on, your best days are still ahead of you. Do you believe that? All right. There's a song I want us to sing this morning, and the bridge says, if I'm not dead, you are not done. Amen. Amen. You're still alive this morning, right? Which means that God is not done with you. God is not finished with you. Amen. So can we sing that? Can you sing with me? Same vir môre, is okay? Is dit reg? I know the people of Standerton can so 'n bietjie sing, want gisteraand het die mense bietjie baie geraas gemaak by Waldie se huis. So Waldie opened up his kitchen door and I was just hearing these people can hulle kan sing en hulle kan hulle hande klap. So kan ek julle vra om op julle to stand this morning with me? We're going to praise God a little bit. Is that okay? Is that okay? All right, is julle lief vir my? Kom ons, is julle lief vir my? Alright, ek is lief vir julle alreeds. Dis my mense. Dis my mense. Dis my mense. Dis my mense. Prys die Here. Alright. Can you put those words up for me? Testimony, please.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done.
Come on, let's sing it.
Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe.
Do you believe that this morning? Ja, maar ek is so 'n bietjie, ek maak so 'n bietjie geraas. Ek is a loud. Oh, is it okay? Is that okay? And what's nice about this building is like your voice just goes, if I'm not dead, you're not done. So can I hear you guys sing this morning? Here we go.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. 'Cause greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe.
Come on, say.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. 'Cause greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe.
Come on.
Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Yes, God. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. 'Cause greater things are still to come. Greater things are still to come in this place, God.
Come on, if you believe that greater things are still to come, can you just agree with me this morning? Come on, just even if you just say amen, God, I believe that greater things are still to come, even in this place, Lord, even in this town, even in this church, that greater things are still to be done, Lord God. We thank you this morning, Lord, as your people. Thank you that you are here. Thank you that your presence is here in this place this morning, Father. We give you glory and we give you honor. And everybody says, amen, amen, amen. It's a bit geraas, né? Ek weet is so hard vanmôre. But it's okay, right? Want jy is mos, ons is mos mense. Is dit reg? I was setting you guys up the whole morning. You guys can quickly grab a seat. We're going to worship just in a moment. But I quickly wanted just to share something with you, if you would allow me. If you have your Bible here this morning, can you go to the book of Luke 19? Luke 19, if you have your Bible. Is it Lucas 19? Lucas 19. The Afrikaans, hy vloei vanmôre. That's a vloei, amen. You know? And I quickly wanted to call this message this morning, Jesus, friend of sinners. Jesus, friend of sinners, amen. You know, there's a saying that goes around when I was growing up, they say, show me your friends and I'll show you your future. Anybody ever heard that? Show me your friends and I'll show you your future, right? And here's the thing. So if you have bad friends, your future's probably going to turn out bad, right? If you have good friends, if you have successful friends, then your future's probably going to turn out success. Is that right? But here's the thing. If you want to have success in the natural, in what's happening in around us, that statement applies. Show me your friends and I'll show you your future. But here comes this man, Jesus, and he says, man, I'm going to be a friend of sinners. So how does that work? I don't understand, because if you show me your friends, I can tell you where I'm going to end. But what I love about Jesus, he was a friend of sinners, but he never became a sinner. He came to influence sinners. Amen? And some of us, sometimes I'm guilty of it as well. When we hear the word sinners, when we hear people that are far from God, we say, man, that's not for me. You know, I greet him from afar. But here's this man, Jesus. If he was walking this earth today, he probably would have been less in church than most of us. Why? Because people said, this man, he hangs out with sinners. What are people saying about us? What are people saying about us as a local church? Are we hanging out with sinners, not becoming them, but influencing them? Amen? I really, really believe that God has called you here to this town for a specific reason. And I don't want you to miss it out. I know there's so much going on at the moment. There's so much talk. There's so much things are being said, right? But how many know that God is bigger than those things? He's bigger than those problems. He's bigger than those obstacles. Amen? Amen? So if you know me, you can ask Valdi and them. If there's something that I'm passionate about, it's people that are far from God. You'll find me with them. You'll find me hang out with them. I look for them every single week, right? And one of these people it's a friend of mine. He hasn't come to Jesus yet, but I believe that he will. He's a barber. He cuts my hair. And this guy's name is Curtis. He comes from a gang. He's an ex-gang banger, they call him. And he's got 3 tattoos here on his neck. And the 3 tattoos is 3 crosses. So I asked him the one day, I said, Curtis, wat gaan aan met die tattoos? He said, oh, you know, and he said to me, he says, I'm not serving, I'm not involved, but I believe in the cross. I believe what happened on this cross. So there's already a seed that's been planted in his life, amen. And whenever I hang out with him, I go cut my hair. And the one day I took my son with me, and Joshua was still 12 at the time, and this guy, man, he swears like a trooper. You know, we're sitting there, and I'm like, oh, my child, what is he going to think of this, you know? And here we in this environment, but I knew that I was able to influence him. I wasn't Bible bashing him. I wasn't telling him how bad he is. How many of you know that people already know? Bad people already know how bad they are, right? They don't need to hear that, right? They need to hear the goodness of Jesus, amen? So I'm hanging out with Curtis, and I'm busy just, you know, influencing his life and walking the road with him. And he started a vegetable garden just on the corner where he was selling veggies. And because I want to be a blessing to him and because I believe in him, I started buying vegetables from him. And if you come to Jeffreys Bay, praise God, I get to stay in an area where I didn't grow up. I get to stay in a little bit of a better area. But I go down to Palsaris, I sit on the corner with him, and I buy his vegetables and I take it home. And the one day I was standing on the corner, I had my shorts on and my slops, and Curtis was standing next to me with all his tattoos. And the next moment there was some men of God that was driving past me. And immediately when I saw them, I started feeling uncomfortable. And I thought to myself, what are they going to think? Because, you know, I'm a pastor. And how can I stand next to this guy? And that day I had to check myself. I had to do some introspection on myself. And saying, you know what, CJ, take your eyes off yourself and what people are going to say about you. You are supposed to be a friend of sinners. And because we are friends of sinners, we'll be able to influence those sinners. Amen? So that's how that's my interaction with people. But here in Luke 19, we see that Jesus gives us an example of what it is for us to interact with people that are far from God. Amen? I got this quote the other day, and it says that if you've encountered the love of Jesus, then that's all you need. If you've encountered the love of Jesus, why? Because the love of God compels us to reach out to people. Amen. We cannot say that we love God, but we don't want to love people. We cannot say that we love God, but we are only hanging out with certain people. Amen. The motivation why God sent his son Jesus to come and die for us, why? Because he loved us. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Right? How crazy is that God didn't have two sons. He had one son. So he didn't have a backup plan and say, man, if they don't accept him, if they don't, see him and take favor in him, I can always send another son. It's the only one that he had. And God was willing to give up everything. He was willing to give up his best for me and you. And here's the scary thing is that he does this as a heavenly father, knowingly maybe that CJ might not accept it. Now that's a father, right? Isn't it? You raise your kids up, you impart into them, and you just pray and hope that one day you're going to reap what you've put in them. Amen? And that's the love of a loving father. So the story reads, and I want to quickly read one in verse 1. And it says here that Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. Jesus entered Jericho and he was passing through. And what was happening is that if you know the story, Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem to be crucified for us to die on the cross, for us to bring us back into relationship with him. And on his way, he encounters a young rich ruler. And as you know the story, he came and he said to Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And as we know, Jesus said to him that if you want to inherit eternal life, you need to give up everything and follow me. And yet this young man said, man, I cannot give up everything. It wasn't about the money, but it was about what was important to him. Jesus was testing his heart. Does he believe? Is his faith and his trust in what he has? And is he willing to give that up to follow Jesus? And the next person Jesus comes in contact with, he comes in with a blind man. And the blind man cries out to Jesus, says, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And as we know, Jesus heals the man. Now, I want you to imagine this morning if that was happening in Standerton and Jesus was on his way to Secunda, for example, right? Don't you think there would have been people everywhere? Isn't it? So thousands of people were following Jesus wherever he was going. Why? Because they knew that he was the miracle maker. Amen. They knew that he would make a way for them. They knew that there was something about him and they just wanted to hang around him. So if we look at, you know, the paparazzi of today, you know, Instagram, Facebook, people would have been writing about him and say, man, Jesus is coming through Standerton to Secunda and this blind man, if I can just get in touch with him, that I know that he's going to heal me, right? And what I love about Jesus is that he's very intentional about everything that he does. He doesn't just wake up in the morning and say, what's going to happen today? Let's see what happens. He wakes up intentional. And I don't know if God spoke to him that morning about Zacchaeus, that he was going to encounter this man. I don't know. Jesus says, I do everything I see my Father does. And I believe that that morning, God might have given him a word that you're going to encounter this specific man, right? And here the story reads, it says that a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was very wealthy. He wasn't just a tax collector, you must understand. He was the chief. So he had some of his cronies that was collecting tax, and they were stealing from the people. And then he comes along with the tax that they give him, and what does he do? He steals even more from the people. So this guy was not popular. He was not the guy that you wanted to be seen with. He was not the guy that you wanted to hang out with. Why? Because the people didn't like him. And here he steps on the scene and we read the story, like I said, about the rich young rulers, that he came to Jesus because he was searching. He said, what must I do? And here Zacchaeus doesn't come to Jesus saying, I'm looking and I'm trying to find out about eternity. He's not talking about that. He says, if I can only see him. Because he heard, man, Jesus was in Standerton and dinge gebeera, mense raak gesond. I heard about Jesus, and if I can just see him. That's what he says. And here it says that he wanted to see who Jesus was. But because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. I mean, I'm not the tallest of guy. You know, I'm pretty short, you know. But I want to quickly land here. And what this man, Zacchaeus, does, he positions himself to encounter Jesus. How many of us sometimes stand in a crowd and what do we say? I'll just stay in the back. You know, pastor's wife comes up and she prays and says, God is here, the Holy Spirit is here, God wants to encounter you. And you say, I would love to encounter him, but I'll stay in the back and I'm not really going to lift up my hands because, you know, I don't want to. And here this man is a tax collector. The people don't like him. And he's on this mission. Why? Because he wants to encounter Jesus. You know that first time when you met your wife, when you saw her and your eyes locked, you're like, oh man, hey Valdi? Valdi was turning red that day. He couldn't speak. It was just crazy. Annika was telling me the story yesterday. But you know, when you see that person for the first time, there's an encounter. Something happens. There's a connection, right? And the Bible says, because he was short, what does he do? He ran ahead and he climbed on a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Isn't that amazing? He runs ahead. He says, I'm going to climb on a tree. And I don't care what the people say. I don't care the name that the people are calling me. If I can just see Jesus, if I can just encounter him. I've heard about him, but I'm sure something is going to happen when I encounter Jesus. And this is what I want to leave with you guys this morning. We're going to carry on just now, but I want us to worship this morning. Amen. And I want us to position our hearts this morning. I say, man, I'm going to position myself. Maybe I need to do something a little bit different this morning, but I want to see Jesus. I want to encounter the love of Jesus. Amen. So can I challenge you with that this morning? Can I push you a little bit with that? We're going to worship now and say, man, Jesus, he's already here. And here's the thing about God is that God is everywhere. We know that God is everywhere, right? But here's the thing about God. He doesn't manifest himself everywhere. And the Bible says that Jesus came to the spot. That's what it says. He literally came to the spot. There were thousands of people around him. But here this one man says, I'm going to position myself for an encounter with Jesus. And what happens? The presence of God manifests itself in that spot. And that's what God wants for you. Maybe this morning is your spot. Maybe this morning is the place that you need to be to encounter Jesus. Maybe you've been saying for years, man, I'm coming to church and I see how God is touching this person. And I see how this person's life is being changed. And I've always had that desire in my heart, but I never knew how I can see and encounter Jesus. All you have to do this morning, my friend, family, onsa mensa, may mensa, we just need to position ourselves for an encounter. Amen. Position ourselves, get ourselves in the right place to encounter Jesus. Amen. So we're going to worship this morning, just one song. And I'm really praying and I'm trusting God this morning that you would see Jesus. You would see Jesus. And as Zacchaeus wanted to see him, he didn't know that Jesus was ready to see him. Isn't that incredible? Man, I love Jesus. He made everything so simple. He made everything so easy for us to come to the Father. Amen. So this morning, I want you to forget about yesterday. I want you to forget about this morning. Maybe you shouted at your wife because you wanted toothpaste and you got upset when you came to church. Forget about all of that. And let's just focus our eyes on him this morning. Say, God, I want to see you. I want to know you. Amen. And since this is an Afrikaans town, I thought that I'll sing an Afrikaans song. Is it okay? So can you let Salman may sing for more? We're going to put the words up on the screen. Salah marker. Salah marker. What does it mean in English again? Salah marker. Salah. Redeemer. Isn't that beautiful? The lyric says, ons noem om Salah marker, want dit is sy reddingsnaam. Isn't that beautiful? I love Jesus. I love sinners because I get to share this with them. I get to be this with them, because I know what God has done in my life and what God can do in their lives. Amen. Can I stand for water? Sorry, mate. Can you put up the song Heilig? Heilig is die Heer. Yeah. Holy is the Lord. The words it says that, the next song, it says, Vul die huis met die glorie. Vul die huis met die glorie. Vul die huis met die teenwoordigheid. Isn't it? I don't speak Afrikaans every day. But when I hear that, met die teenwoordigheid. Not with CJ, not with my ability, not with my voice, not with my keyboard, but met die teenwoordigheid. Can I just this morning say, man, we are going to be like Zacchaeus. we're gonna, whatever the people say, the people who come lach you and why are you doing what you are doing? I'm not gonna look at that. Why? Because I want to encounter Jesus. Amen. Let's sing it together this morning.
Want alles is door en alles is dier. Openbaren ons in heerlijkheid.
Kom maar, vul die eis.
Vul die eis met die glorie. Vul die eis met die glorie. Vul die eis met die teenwoordigheid. Want alles is dier.
Sounds beautiful, come on.
Vul die eis met die. Vul die eis met die. Alles wat dier. Want alles is. En alles is door. Openbaren ons die heerlijkheid. Openbaren ons die heerlijkheid. Met die glorie, vul die eis met die glorie. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the dark.
Come on, sing it.
Hearts will
That God's presence is here. The reason why we lift up our hands, all that it is, that we just, it's a sign of surrender. It's a God, I surrender to you. We recognize that you are here. Here's the thing about the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. He doesn't just come and just do his own thing. He comes where he's welcome. He comes where he is acknowledged. There's nothing like when you walk into a room and people don't even acknowledge you. You stand in the corner and they don't even look at you. And sometimes I feel when it comes to the Holy Spirit that he's in the room and we don't acknowledge him. But Holy Spirit, this morning, I want to say that we acknowledge you. We acknowledge your presence in this place. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. We recognize that you are here, Jesus.
There is none like you. No one else can touch my like you do. I can search for all eternity, Lord, and find there is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I can search for all, I can search for all eternity, Lord, and find there is none like you.
Amen. How many know that this place, Standerton, would be so different if this presence and this atmosphere is in our homes? It is where we go to work. It is with the people that we encounter. Church, I come from a small town, and I've seen over the years that people have been waiting for a political agenda, for a political leader to rise up, and he's going to be the one that's going to help us. I come from a colored neighborhood in Jeffreys Bay where there are people are frustrated, the people are, they just don't know what to do. But man, I'm telling you, We shouldn't look for a political leader that's going to come and do something. Why? Because we know Jesus. Amen. He's the one that will come and bring the change that we are so desperately need. Amen. And it's going to take us as God's people for that. You know? Come on, somebody say, no more negativity. Right? We want to release the presence and the atmosphere of the glory of God wherever we find ourselves. Amen. Because the Bible says, Christ in me, Christ in you. What is it? The hope of glory. The hope is not out there. The hope is not on the TV. The hope is not on the next announcement that the president is going to make. Christ in us, the hope of glory. So wherever I go, there is hope. Wherever I go, I share the love of Jesus with people. Amen. So you guys want to sit quickly? Can we finish the story of Zacchaeus? Is it okay? Is my tijd nog okay, pastoor? Is ik nog recht? Kom, Ati, je gooi me maar net, ne? Alright. Cool, I'm gonna finish quickly. Come on, how many of you love the presence of God? It's just amazing, huh? We get to just be there. I can be here the whole day and just be there. I want to go to verse 5. And when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up to him and said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. Why is this so important? Why is it important for Jesus to call Zacchaeus by his name? Because Zacchaeus' name means pure. That's what his name means. It means pure. So Jesus doesn't look at him and say, you tax collector, you chief tax collector, come down because I need to come to your house today. Jesus says, no, I see you for who you are. I see you for how my heavenly Father has created you. And I think I am guilty sometimes as well when I'm out there in the real world and how my interaction with people is that I look at the things that they've done wrong. I look at where they're at and I'm judging as a believer, I'm judging sinners. But I don't call out the purpose and the plan that God has placed in them. And here Jesus comes and he encounters Zacchaeus and he calls out the purpose and the destiny in him. Amen. And in verse 7 it says here that all the people saw this and began to mutter. People are funny, huh? People are funny. They'll be like, man, this person is going through this. And then they'll say, het jy gehoor? Ons moet bid. Because, you know, so-and-so is going through this and is going through that. And it's going, isn't it ekker? You don't have to lift up your hands. It's just me. But the people, they muttered and they probably say the most profound statement that I really, really live by. They say, he has gone to be the guest of sinners. That's what he did. And Mark 2 verse 17 says, on hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinner. I'm telling you people, how many people out there today are sick? The result of what they are doing, why? Because they are sick. That's it. And Jesus says, I didn't come for those that are healthy. I came for the ones that are sick. And where are people sick? In Proverbs 13 verse 12, it says, an unrelenting disappointment leaves your heart sick. Continual disappointment. You know, people keep finding out there's no jobs, there's no work. They keep finding out, man, I'm struggling and people are talking negative about me. Whenever I'm in the presence of people, they don't tell me what can come through me. They tell me what is wrong with me. So the Bible says an unrelenting disappointment. You know, the disappointment after disappointment, thing after thing that's happening, what does it do? It causes and it leaves you heart sick. But a sudden good break can turn your life around. That's in the Bible. When I read it, I was like, is that in the Bible? But a sudden good break can turn your life around. Here's this man by the name of Zacchaeus. Been disappointed how many times? How many times people have spoken bad about him? He probably knew what I'm doing is wrong. I shouldn't be stealing from people. And he's walking around hopeless. Hopeless with a heart that is sick. And suddenly when he locks eyes with Jesus, there's a breakthrough. And as the Bible says, it turned his life completely around. Completely around. And I want to finish in verse 8. But Zacchaeus stood up And this is now when Jesus was inside of his house. Zacchaeus stood up and he said to the Lord, "Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor." Remember, Jesus told the rich young ruler, "I want you to go and sell everything," right? And yet Jesus doesn't say to Zacchaeus, "Go and sell everything." Zacchaeus responded and said, "I will give everything and I will give more what I have stolen." Why? Because the Bible says it is the goodness of God that leads men to repentance. And all Jesus was doing that day, he was good to Zacchaeus. That's it. He was good to him. He loved him. He saw potential in him. He saw purpose in him. He saw destiny in him. And because of he experienced the goodness of God, it led him to repentance. And I'm going to show you now why I say that. Amen. And why is this important? I always read the scripture and I ask myself, well, why is this important? Why is it important that we need to hear what he was going to do? Because Zacchaeus, he was a Jew. So he understood the law. He understood what you need to do when you steal from somebody. And when we go to the book of Leviticus 6, we actually find out what you're supposed to do when you steal from people, right? But I'm not going to read it now if you want to go and read that. But in a few verses down, I think it's in verse 9, he's supposed to pay back everything, but he's supposed to take something to the priest. And the priest is supposed to go and make atonement for him, right? And what I love about Zacchaeus is that he realizes that I don't have to go to the priest because the priest is here in my home and he will make atonement for me. Isn't that incredible? I was like, whoa, this is amazing. Like, look at the scripture. This is just awesome how everything comes to life, right? And when I read in Hebrews 4 verse 14, it says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness." What does this high priest do? He looks at Zacchaeus and he sees a man that is broken. He sees a man that has been told how many times you're doing this and you're doing that. And he says, "Zacchaeus, I'm here because I empathize with you." And he says, "But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." This morning, you're already a believer. You've already given your life to Jesus. And I'm praying this morning that this message would remind you of what happened in your life when you came to know Jesus. Why? So that when you see sinners, when you see people far from Jesus, that you can say, "Man, I need to be hope to this person. I need to speak life into this person. I cannot tell people how they're this sinners and they're this bad. I need to love people." Why? Because I need to show them the goodness of God, because that is what's going to lead them to repentance. Amen. This month in this church, the theme is get in the game. Get in the game. I want to encourage you, it's time to get into the game. And not just here on a Sunday, but it's time to get into the game Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and back here on a Sunday. Amen? Amen? So can you stand on your feet this morning? I want to pray for you guys before I close. In verse 9, Jesus says to him, he said, "Today, salvation has come to this house." Today, salvation has come to this house. Salvation is in this house this morning. Maybe you're standing here this morning and you have been at that place of disappointment. Continual disappointment, continual bashing, it's just like things are not going the way they're supposed to go. Maybe you are heart sick this morning. You know, the Bible says out of that flows everything. So if your heart is not well, what's going to flow out of it? Salvation is in the house this morning. The high priest, Jesus, that knows where you are, he's in the house this morning. And I want you to step out like Zacchaeus. He said, "Man, I'm going to climb a tree. Whatever I need to do, because I want to see Jesus. I want to encounter this Jesus." And the last piece in verse 10, he says that, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." And what does Jesus do in verse 10? He makes clear what his mission is. He says, "I'm not here for anything else that you might have thought of. I'm here to seek those that are lost and to save them." Jesus' mission is our mission. Amen. It's our mission. We are not excluded from the mission once we've given our lives to Jesus. We are part of the mission. So we need to get in the game. Come on, we need to get into the game. Amen. With every eye closed, if I'm speaking to you this morning, you say, CJ, first of all, I need to make my life right with Jesus. I need to come back to him. I need to have an encounter with him here this morning. On the count of three, I want you just to pop up your hand and we're going to pray together with you as a family. Are you ready? One, two, three. If that's you, just pop up your hand and we're going to pray together. No one's looking around. Come on, this is your moment with God. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, let's pray together. Say, Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. Today, I receive the gift of salvation. I thank you, Jesus, that you died for me to reconcile me with the Father. I thank you, God, that my sins are forgiven and that I will spend eternity with you. But while I'm here on earth, your mission is my mission, and that is to seek and save the lost. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can we give them a hand this morning? Hallelujah. And as Pastor Gerrit comes up, the theme for this month is get in the game. Get in the game. I want to see by the showing of hands who's going to get into the game. Come on, who's getting into the game? Next time I want to come here, I want to hear, you know, Valdi, Vriend van Sondaars. Is it right? Vriend van Sondaars. You know what I mean? So we're going to get into the game, church. Come on, we're going to get into the game and say this. We're going to be game changers. Come on, we're going to be game changers. Amen? All right, fantastic. Thank you so much for having me. God bless you guys. And I really hope that you receive the word of the Lord this morning. Amen. Bless you.
Kan ons om een lekker aan het lap geven morgen. Prijs de naam van de Heer. And I really believe that there's such an anointing to speak in tongues this morning. Kan jy dit hoor? Ek praat in Engels, so dit is goed. Prys die naam van die Here, so goed om saam met julle te kan wees. Ek wil 'n laaste guns vanoggend vir u vra, net voordat ons gaan afsluit en voordat ons gaan verdag. Kan ek u vra dat ons weer net ons oë sal toemaak asseblief? CJ, kan ek jou vra om vir my so saggies net te speel asseblief hierso? Ek is met my hele hart oortuig, my broer en suster, dat God is in die besigheid van genesing. Jesus red en Jesus genees en hy doop nog deur sy gees. En so is ek bang dat baie keer kom ons by mekaar en ons bid nie vir mense wat siek is nie. Ons bid nie vir mense wat behoeftig is nie. En ons laat dit maar net verby gaan baie keer. En miskien doen ons 'n fout deur dit te doen. So ek wil vanoggend vir elkeen die geleentheid gee. Kan ek jou sê, hy het dit net al gesê, God is in die huis. God is hier. En ons is nie die dokters nie. God is die dokter. Kan ons vanmôre net vir 'n oomblik, en ek impliseer nou nie vanoggend dat u is siek nie, dis nie wat ek sê nie. Maar is daar vanoggend, as daar vanoggend iemand hier is, wat sê, Here, ek het u nodig, ek het nodig dat u my sal aanraak, dan wil ek jou vraag, my broer en suster, dis jou oomblik, dis jou moment hierdie. Miskien dalk het jy nie net genesing nodig nie, miskien het jy dalk ook 'n finansiële deurbraak nodig. Ek sê, miskien dalk het jy 'n finansiële deurbraak nodig. En miskien is dit al vanoggend, jou oggend, waar die Here begin dinge omdraai. En ek hou van wat Pastor CJ gesê het vanmôre, deur net vorentoe te tree en sê, Here, hier is ek. Ek klim in die boom. Ek wil die aangesig tot aangesig wil ek hier sien. So kan ek vanmôre vir u vra en ek maak nie van jou 'n verleentheid nie. Ons doen nie dit nie. Ons speel nie daai game nie. Maar ek gaan jou vra vanoggend as jy seer het in jou lyf en jou liggaam, as jy seer het in jou finansies, as jy seer het in verhoudings, as jy seer het in weet nie waar jy moet wees en wat jy moet doen nie, dan wil ek jou vra vanoggend net vir 'n oomblik. Kom ons bid saam. En as jy vanoggend die ou is met wie ek praat, kom ons maak ons geloof prakties deur te sê, Here, sien my raak. Het jy gehoor dat daar was 'n jonge dame gewees met die naam van Maria? En sy het op die einde van die dag, as jy die Bybel gaan lees in Lukas 1, Here, dankie dat U my raak gesien het. Kom ek waarborg jou, my broer en suster, daar's mense wat raak gesien wil word. Nie deur mense nie, maar deur God. Voel jy ook so? So Vader, dankie dat ons vanoggend ons hande kan uitstrek. En Here, ons wil ons geloof in U as die groot geneesheer stel. Here, ons wil ons geloof stel in U as die een wat deurbraak gee. Here, ons wil ons geloof in U stel as die een wat in 'n oomblikse tyd, Here, in 'n aandse tyd van armoede tot oorvloed kan bring. En Here, as pastoor van hierdie gemeente, as familie van hierdie gemeente, Here, wil ek op hierdie kansel staan en wil ek 'n ommeswaai aankondig en profeteer van hierdie oomblik af in die naam van Jesus. Here, ek profeteer vandag deur my geloof te aktiveer en te sê, van hierdie oomblik af sal daar 'n verandering kom in finansies, in liggame wat nie gesond is nie, in die naam van Jesus. En ons strek ons hande uit vanoggend, ons sê Here, ons glo U en ons eer U daarvoor in die naam van Jesus. Halleluja, halleluja.